Source. You could, just for other reactor sources, you would use a slightly different parameters. There are some that are included in the documentation of the component, so we can use that if you want to. If we just use this, as I say, it's an intensity at a given wavelength drawn from a sum of up to three normalized Maxwellian distributions. If you only specify T1 and I1, the other ones would be considered zero. They would just be a simple one, together with one single Maxwellian distribution. And that's just putting it into math what it really is. And this is unfortunately not so something that you can see very well. It's discernible, but this is, if I just do this and catch this on a L monitor, as you've already used, you can sort of kind of see the distribution of it. Should have done that. If you look at the slideshow later on, it will be there. Now, and just for fun, if we remove the first peak, then this is what you get. Basically, it just removes the shorter wavelength peak of it, and it distorts the historical wavelength spectrum. Then obviously this is no longer a very good representation of the PSI pulses. So it just shows that you can manipulate these factors as you want. If we take a look at the input parameters, the way they would look if you were to do NCDoc or use the website, you see something like this, and it should be reasonably clear what it is that we're doing. Perhaps interesting parameters are the L min and L max. You can limit the emitted wavelength band to some other some band that you're interested in, and that again analogous to the focusing window. That means that you only look at, you only sample intensity from a certain wavelength band. It does not mean that there is no intensity outside of it. It just means that you're not computing it. So you have to remember this. If you don't compute it, it doesn't mean that it's not there. But it can be very useful if you have a monochromator. So there's another source called Source Gen. It's actually the same as Source Maxwell, Source Maxwell 3. It has one feature that's different. It means that, and this is that you can use flux files. You can use a measurement or a computed spectrum file as an input instead of using three Maxwell inputs. That's what it is. Why then would we have two different source models? Well, that's the, as Peter mentioned, there's a lot of MaxStas is a community code. A lot of components actually originate from outside of the team itself. We don't write it, we haven't started everything ourselves. And that means that someone thought that this was a very nice way of doing it, or two people have done the same. Written the same component or similar components at the same time, and just to continue to support these users, we have decided to keep them both around. Now, to MCPL, I promised I would talk to you about this. And if this read these two input and output reads and writes events directly from an MCPL file. That means that we don't actually generate the MaxStas neutron ray events from distributions anymore. We just read them from a file. And those events could be generated by MCP or Fluca or anything else that is some, for instance, some code that was specialized in doing moderated calculations, targets, stuff, or MCP itself, in fact. And then it would just directly read that in into your simulation and start the simulation from there. I put up some examples of this. It's quite simple to use. You put your output and you put your input and just mention which file it is that you're using. Now, as you know by now, we do have a position to these endpoints and start points. And this means that there can be an implicit translation in this if you're not careful. I'll try to explain what I mean by that. If you have MCP as output at some point, that means that what is going to be written into the file are distributions or events which happen to have some spatial coordinates. Okay? Now, when we go to input these, if this, the input, that is the position of the input component, happens to be different than the position of the output component, that means that the neutrons have actually moved. So this, you have to be a little bit careful about. So that just saying that you can move your neutrons if you want to, but again, if you don't want to, then you have to be careful. Merely inputs.
So what on top of that? Does anybody have an idea what one would write to get the absolute instrument coordinates? Does anyone have an idea what to do?
It's a little bit cool. Absolutely.
That's what you do. Yeah. Yes.
Just as you've seen for the first component in all of your instrument files, it's called usually a progress bar. Exactly. So you get. If you do that, then it will be fine. Okay. So we happen to be on a pulsed source now. So you really want to know about pulsed sources, I guess a few of you, at least. In fact, this, for the simplest case of doing a pulsed source with MCStas, you could in fact just use a continuous source. And what do I mean by that? But that means that the time in the neutron state vector is set to zero. So you have an infinitely short pulse length. I guess facilities sometimes would like that. All the neutrons would start at time equals zero. So if you were to monitor the time distribution later on, you would in fact see a spread in time. Why would that be? Does anyone know?
Yeah, actually for the existence in instrument, we already noticed that.
Yeah,
there's a time delay from by 20 or 100 microseconds.
Yeah.
So it caused some problem for the fans there. So we're trying to know how to track it there.
Yeah. So, I mean, just because the wavelength spread of the neutron means that they travel at different speeds, but if they start at time zero, then they end up being arriving at different times. So, it merely means, actually, that for any continuous source simple, source Maxwell 3, or whatever you use, it just means that on a reactor, you just don't use the time for anything. But it's actually set to zero. So, I have a sample here. That would, or a tough monitor. Or a different way of adding time resolution to a continuous source would be to add a chopper. Since we're dealing with simulations, we can have a disk chopper that spins at an arbitrary speed, which means that you can chop your signal just any, you can create whatever time window you want, without thinking of the engineers who have to build the actual chopper. So that's a different way of doing it.
Yeah. So just a small spoiler there. It's simply that when you use a chopper on the reactor source, we have a parameter called is first, and that then automatically defines the emission time to be one that corresponds to the opening. And it means there's no loss. Actually, the chopper doesn't really chop. The first one just redefines time to match the time window.
Then the initial timing.
Yeah. So
you could do that with the chopper as well. And then you could get an arbitrary length time opening instead of just the infinitely short one. There's a different one that we will also be taking a closer look at on Friday, called a moderator. Again, I'm trying to put this into math. It looks more complicated than it really is. But it models a flat pulse source with a uniform energy spectrum. So we have a uniform wavelength distribution or energy distribution. And that's the way it goes. And then the time structure of it is given by an energy-dependent probability distribution that looks more or less like this. So below some threshold, it gets flat. And then it drops off in terms of the energy, is what I'm trying to say. So there is a time delay to it. And on Friday, we'll be taking a look at how to introduce energy dependence in the initial wavelength distribution for this, which is probably something that could be very useful to model the CSNS source.
Is that an example or wait?
This is just an example.
Okay. Yeah. Wait, sorry.
Given by the default parameters to this one, but you can change all of these numbers. So then there's the SNS source, which samples directly from tallies coming from, for instance, MCP calculations. It's a community component that comes from our contributed from outside, particularly the SNS. But it's also used extensively at JPAR, for instance, there. And it can be used to model the CSNS source. There is an example that's coming in the next McStas distribution.
And we agreed, walking to lunch, that we will also, of course, put it in the repository as is.
Yes.
So the school repository will also get this.
Yes, definitely. That's merely a data bug. It actually comes from was kindly contributed to this, and it will be included in the next release. And as I said, Peter said mentioned here, it will be available to you if you want to really do things using something that's actually real.
So that, to my understanding, it was the decoupled hydrogen moderator that is more. Yeah. So just one of the suite of moderators, of course, but it's a start.
And if you just look at what's coming from this, it will look, if you were to be able to see it, it looks like this. You can sort of kind of see that it has this kind of something aspect on it. Anyway, that's just putting a wavelength monitor behind it.
You know what? I can't remember what the shortcut is, but there's a way to make the screen negative and I'll just check. Maybe there's in the viewer. I'll just check. You're just looking at the PDF, right?
Yeah.
There's some inversion. Yeah, I'll look it up.
There is also this version here from CSNS Analytic, CSNS Source Analytic, which basically samples again, samples from a set of analytic functions. It's called Pi functions, which are fitted, have been fitted to the tallies that were used for the SNS source. It's much faster than the than sampling directly from the tallies. It also leads to cleaner distributions where statistics are scarce, which means, what I say, mean by that is that if you have, when you get to the lower intensity regions of your spectrum, then there might be very little statistic there in the original tally files, which means that there the distribution is kind of flaky, and that leads to can lead to some strangeness going on there. You have strange bumps in the spectrum because mainly just because you don't have very much statistics there. But if you fit a suite of functions to it, then you usually get something smoother that also extends to the tails of this thing. But it does require a rather complex fitting campaign. So at this point, it can be used as analytic, but it's rather difficult to use it. So at this point, I don't quite recommend doing it. But if you're up to it, if you want to spend a few weeks fitting functions, then so that might be a way to go. You will end up with something that's much faster. And again, this can also be used to model a proper CSNS source. There's something that's particularly coming from ISIS, that's probably not very relevant to you guys, but the people at ISIS have spent quite some time modeling through MCP their sources, their beam ports, and so on, so that if you want to use them, they are there, and there are data files for all of the beam ports for ISIS, where to compare. What would your instrument perform like if it were to be put at ISIS, for instance? I'm not sure how much meaning that would be. But, this is some, again, an example of that, which you can't see, so I'll skip it. So, this concludes my tour of the various source models. Let's look at monitors. Here's an overview of monitors. These are not all the monitors that are present. If you have looked in the insert menu of your GUI, you see that there are lots and lots of monitors. I've tried to dissolve them into 1D monitors that give you a curve, 2D monitors that give you an image, if you will, a pixelated image. And then there is the NB thing. I'll talk more about that. So you have an L monitor, the volume stuff. It monitors intensity as a function of wavelength. There's a TOF monitor, time of flight monitor. It monitors intensity as a function of time. There's the HDIV monitor, which is monitoring intensity as a function of divergence along in the x direction. So the two first ones have sort of counterparts in the real world, but if you go to divergence monitors, these are monitors that only exist in computers, right? There is something called mean pole lambda, which is the mean polarization as a function of wavelength. There's also a mean monitor, intensity as a function. As a function of energy. Perhaps it's worth spending a little time on the mean pole lambda. If anyone's interested in polarization, this is then monitoring the mean value of the polarization as a function of lambda. So it will give you a number along a specified direction, I should say. So you specify a vector along which you want to measure the polarization, and if at the end you will get a number between one and minus one and one, saying that okay, the polarization along this vector is here at this point. Now it has a counterpart. If we go to the 2D ones, you've already seen the PSD one. There's the PSD monitor 4pi. I usually call that the dream monitor of crystallographers. It is a monitor that is a full spherical shell, i.e. full 4pi coverage. So again, that only exists in a computer. Because there will be no way for the neutrons to enter this monitor if it were such a real life. But and so it monitors intensity as a function of latitude and longitude, say. And I find it very useful to put around one of these around when you put a sample inside your simulation. If you want everyone to know where are my neutrons going. It's useful to put one of these around it, because then you will actually see where are they going. Are they being scattered in some direction because you have managed to, if you're clumsy like me, then you once in a while make mistakes. That's a very useful trick to find mistakes that you've made. There's a divergence monitor in two dimensions now, so you get a two-dimensional picture of divergence, and there's also a two-dimensional monitor called DivPos monitor, which monitors divergence and position, which again is something that only exists in a computer, but can give you useful insight as to what does my beam look like where, and where do I have the most divergence. If I were to change something, if I were to optimize my instrument differently, would I? Where do I get my divergence? Right. So, and then there's the other one. There's another one called lambda monitor, which is it's intensity as a function of polarization and wavelength. So this will give you a two-dimensional picture of the polarization against some vector. But it will also tell you, in addition to the other one, it will now also tell you something about what does the spread of polarization look like. What kind of distribution of polarization do I have at this point and wavelength? That one is kind of interesting because it doesn't have. All of the other ones have intensity as the measured function, right? As the signal is in neutrons per second. Whereas in that case, the signal is actually polarization. Then we come to the last one, the monitor in D, which can monitor intensity as a function of X, X being anything. And you can measure intensity as a function of x and y, where x means something and y means something else. Usually, it's just x and y, but it can also be whatever you can think of.
Like a q, d,
and so on.
Yeah, so it has a grammar, and all the normal quantities we talk about in Newton scattering are in there. And if you can think of something else, there's
not
the ability
to
use a user. You could do a user-defined quantity. It's basically any C expression. So you do the sign of something times whatever expression you want, you can do.
Or you can in fact make it monitor something else than intensity as a function of something else and something else and something third. But it can be quite complicated to use. Flexibility and complexity go hand in hand. So I'll give you a couple of examples of how to write this thing. You can't really monitor.
On this question, any idea to consider position resolution contribution from the PSD model?
So something exists already for that. There are multiple ways, mm-hmm. right? We have, so you mentioned PSD detector, right?
Yeah.
And that's coming?
Then
I won't say a lot about that. This you tell the full story about. We have something in there called PSD monitor underscore PSF underscore EFF or something like that, where you define a Gaussian point spread function. So you adjust that to match your resolution, and that's also an efficiency. So you do a one over lambda efficiency there. So there are ways to do that.
Yeah. So
we can define an external function to the model.
Yeah.
Yes. So you would add a Gaussian point spread function. So what the monitor will see is a neutron ray arriving at some spatial coordinates, which will then be artificially blurred. So you know that the center is here, but the
blur by the Gaussian function.
Yeah, but that you then actually. So once you know the center of it, which is where the ray hits, you will then sample from a Gaussian distribution centered around that and see where do we actually record it. Which kind of sort of makes sense.
We'll show that in your practitioner?
Not today. I can put it in, but
we can.
But we can. We can easily put it in. I'll make that while we do the exercise. So let's take a few quick examples. You already know this one, the L monitor. You've seen it. You've seen the parameters of it. But let's take a look at what do they actually mean. What is it that McStas does inside its monitors? You may remember that I mentioned that we compute these as running sums. So if you think of a histogram, say for instance, a wavelength monitor, then you have a number of bins, and in whatever bin, a number of events have hit or have been put, and the intensity recorded during the simulation is basically all of the weights that have been put into that, or is the sum of the weights of all the arrays that have been coming in, and the RMS variance over that simply becomes an error estimate. If you noticed on your curves, there are actually error bars on there. And these are the statistical error bars that we compute from this. And these, we should remember that these are actually Monte Carlo errors. So these are errors that are on our Monte Carlo estimate. They're not related to the noise in the instrument or any such thing. They are simply related to how accurate is the simulation. Now, you've already seen a few of these.
Let me
do a trace by all the entities. Some of you have already figured out that the first one, the I, means the intensity. Now this is the integrated intensity over all the monitor. So this is, these are, in this case, it is basically the sum of all of these, all of these data points. I was difficult to read that, but you can see there's something called error, which is the error bar on that number, on the intensity number. And that is, again, it's the Monte Carlo, estimating Monte Carlo error from this. So it says something about your, the quality of your system, of your simulation. There is an n equals something, and that means how many neutron events have arrived at this monitor. That has no no direct bearing on the I number. Merely, the higher the N number, the lower the Monte Carlo error happens to be. So the more events you have, the higher the quality of your simulation is going to be. Now in this case I've got 650,000 events, which means that some of my events have, I started with a million, so some of them, my events have gotten lost somewhere. Now, if this number is zero, that means that you have no estimate at all. It doesn't mean that the intensity has to be zero. It just means that there is no estimate. Now, it's also kind enough to compute the first and second moments of it, of the, this curve here. So it computes a mean in x, which is about here, and then a spread, a statistical spread of this along the x variable. Now again, it doesn't, this is merely, this is mere statistics. It doesn't tell you anything about, you still have to look at the curve to see the shape of it, but it gives you an idea of the width of the.
But where does DS come from?
That's actually the, it's the weighted average.
It's just average.
It's just the mean over whatever is on the monitor.
Yeah.
So I mean, if it was a Gaussian, it would be close to the center. Here it would be.
Yeah.
It would be affected by the tail here.
Yeah.
So it's just an extremely simple average and a spread. That's all it is.
If you know that if this happened to be a symmetric curve, then you could use that to find the, to track the center of your curve. But in this case, it's it is the mean, no more nor less, and the dx is any variance or mean square root of the mean. The same actually goes for the PSD monitor. You will recognize this by now. There's an intensity, there's an error on the number of that. There's a number of events that go into this. It also computes the mean in X and Y, and also the variance in the second moment in both directions. It's a crude measure of where your peak happens to be, but it's useful. Well, it's useful to get a quick estimate of it, but it is not a very clever estimate. It isn't fitted to anything. It's just a mean. Now
shift
the now, if we take a slight look at that, you can actually use this to you can use the error bars to figure out something about, we can estimate noise levels in a real experiment by using this, in a sense. So you basically go through this. This is what we simulate for intensity. Now please remember that in McStas we compute neutrons per second. So that when you get an intensity number, it is an intensity number. When you do a real experiment, you get a number of counts. So that you would have, because when you open your shutter or whatever, you do it for a few seconds or something like that. And that means that you integrate over time. And if you just were to integrate a McStas number over time, which you could do, but then you would also integrate the error bar. So at some point this sort of kind of fails, because you also increase the error bar.
So when we increase that number, just multiply by a sin number for error and intensity, or we have to multiply it by a square.
So you should think of kind of integration time. So you multiply your intensity by that. But then this paper here, you can read the details of that. But it turns out, as will be in the next slide, it turns out there's a simple relationship that tells you kind of what is the maximal measurement time that this would correspond to. And it simply boils down to not violating the Poisson statistics of the square root of intensity. So the scale version of this RMS error bar, these should always correspond. The error bar should never get too low, the square root error bar.
If you do the square root error bar, at some point, if you just multiply by the count time, you end up with something that could be negative. And that doesn't make any sense. You can't have negative counts. So in the next slide, so you could just multiply by t, as it says down here, to get a simulated count time. But if you follow the sort of volumes that fall down, this actually gives you an upper limit to how much. But it says T max down here. And what it means is that there is a maximum number that you can, maximum count time that your simulation is valid for. Which means that if you go above this, if you multiply anything, if you integrate by longer than this, then you end up violating this problem. And you get. You might actually have negative counts, which is wrong. So, and again, it boils down to the fact that the error bar that we get are error bars on the quality of the simulation, not noise count, noise on the peak count or anything else. And so, if you were to do something about this, to increase the Tmax that you could use it for, you would have to run more gates, thereby decreasing the Monte Carlo error bars, and thereby increasing this number. So that's just a way of thinking that to compare the real statistics, you need to have a good enough simulation. So to sketch this, if you take given McStas histogram for the small non-zero bins, again, zero bins means that you have no noise, so that integrating it doesn't make any sense. But you can calculate this Tmax in the small, the smallest Tmax defines the maximum count, blah, blah, blah. And as mentioned there, it's preferable to add some background. So this background, to get a something that looks real. This background has to be somehow relevant for the instrument. But it's not something that you, by definition, get from the McStas simulation. You don't get background as... we normally don't get background. There are ways that we can...
Is it safe to have a background?
Once your instrument is constructed, of course you can add an experimental value in there. That's what you would do. Otherwise, I guess you would attempt to do this with MCAP somehow. But it's difficult. So background originating from parts of the simulation which is around the sample, in the sample. This we can do, but the real source term, so very high energy illusions, for instance, from the source, that's inaccessible.
But if you look at, as Mats was showing, a power sample where you've got incoherent scattering as background, that we can simulate. Mm-hmm. So that's something that's present in the simulation. So that background is a lot of things, I suppose.
Yeah, and the same for contribution of scattered illusions from your sampling environment or the container that has your sampling. These things you can estimate, but any high energy term that comes from the production of your facility, the illusion production, that's hard to quantify by terms of McStas. You will need something other than that.
But the background from sample cells is already included.
Yes. Yes.
Right. So let's take a look at monitoring the all-in-one Swiss Army knife of monitors. So European. A Swiss Army knife is an understood concept. I don't know. Do you know? You guys know what a Swiss Army knife is? it's a general utility tool that you can have in your pocket. It's actually a screwdriver and various points of screwdriver and a nail file if you can polish your nails. You can actually. There's a knife as well. A piece of scissors. You can do anything with it. We have the monitoring lead. Can monitor anything as a function of whatever, have almost any shape. But as trying to sketch here, there is an American expression called "there is no such thing as a free lunch," which means that if you get a free lunch, you probably have to pay for it some other way. Which means that, and the point of that statement is just that it can be a bit complicated to use. Because you can do so many things. So I put together a couple of examples here. The simple one, the first one here, is merely a PSD. So it has a width and a height, it has no depth, which makes sense. It has some options, string, which says intensity per square centimeter. Angle with limits of -5 to -5. Someone asked about the second one. Someone asked about how to do. Peter showed a 1D curve of diffraction peaks on powder. That was recorded by one of these. It's called. Well, if you write this option string, then the monitor will become a banana-shaped thing, which is just a cylinder, a piece of a cylinder, as a function of theta and y. So it has height and angle, but as a banana-shaped thing. Or you can do something more complicated here, where you monitor the k vector of the neutron, or the absolute value, the log of the absolute value of the time, and of the k vector, and then you generate a list of all these events. So that's again an event file, kind of an event mode detector, where you store a few things that you mentioned all the time. So you can monitor functions of the neutron state. And you can go as far as monitor just about anything. In this case, we have defined a user variable that's called user 1, called age, which is something that you just compute somewhere. You mention something so that the monitor knows what to print on the axis. So you will monitor intensity as a function of the age of the captain. And what does the age of the captain mean? It can mean, well, anything. That you put into the value, that you put into the variable h. So you add some extra code in your simulation that computes this number, and then you can monitor that as a function of neutron effect. I'm not sure it makes sense to monitor the age of the captain, but you can. And with these things, if you see the option string is actually quite simple here. You just monitor the user block with automatic limits. And that means that you monitor the what is actually being written to the file is the age intensity as a function of the age of the captain.
Where do I prove the age function?
That is something that you compute. We will be talking about that later on. But you can add in a simulation. There we have facilities to add extra code to it, where you compute some of them. For instance, the age number. The age does not make any sense, but you can add extra computations to the simulation in this way. It's called an extent. And let's we'll try to do an exercise because now you've been listening to me, so you're probably extremely bored with me. If you head on to the same place as you were before, there was an exercise that you can start doing. It just is a matter of putting in a source and some monitors, and then trying to do that again with the monitor and see. Okay.